Hello everyone, I hope you guys are doing good. Today we'll be starting with a new series revolving around statistical psychology. Let's get started. Now, a few warnings. This is not the best way to kick off if you are new to psychology. Statistical psychology is an academic-oriented field of psychology, so you will not be able to relate much to it, unlike the fields of social or abnormal psychology. Next, of course, there is going to be some maths involved. This is where you get your pillow to hug it while you weep. Third, if you have any trouble following around, please switch on the captions. A favorite quote of mine regarding statistics in general, there are three types of lies: lies, damn lies, and statistics. This was said by Benjamin Disraeli. Google him up if you wish to know more about him. So what is statistics? Well, statistics refers to three things. It can mean numerical facts, methods of acquiring those facts, and also the way to summarize the findings of these facts. Tate said it best when he said, "You compute statistics, as in mean, median, mode, etc., from statistics, as in numerical data, by statistics, as in statistical methods." An academic definition would be that it is a subject which helps you collect, analyze, present, and interpret numerical facts. Think of numerical facts as something very interesting. It may be hard for you, but a true admirer of mathematics does not find it difficult. Like anyone who admires something, you wish to collect it, understand it, and present it to the world. While presenting it, you want to explain people about the impact and consequences of the thing. The same story runs with statistics and numerical facts. I know what you're thinking. Man, I left maths back in high school because of quadratic equations, and this guy is asking me to study it again. I get it, but don't worry. The maths involved is not so complex with psychological statistics, and the benefit you reap is tremendous. You can observe facts around you and explain them to people, or you can go ahead and create evaluation tests, such as psychological evaluation tests or physical evaluation tests. These are all standardized tests which have been created with the help of statistics in order to study individual differences better. Moving on, do I even need to mention the amount of relief statistics provides us in the field of experimentation and surveys? It helps us pick the right items for our tests and improves the replicability, which is basically the ability to do the test again and achieve the same result. All in all, statistics puts the science back in psychology. Now, let's just say you and your friend Raymond are out drinking one night. Drunk driving is a dangerous practice. While you are returning home, the cops pull you over. A cop takes off his hat and asks you, what is he holding in front of you? You fail to recognize it. He asks you, what is 2 plus 2? And you say, 22? Because you can't think straight. The cops have a rough punishment procedure for you, which involves a lot of apology and heavy fines. You somehow reach home and conclude that drunk driving is not the best practice, maybe. Maybe you'll get caught the next time you do it, and everyone who drinks and drives gets caught by the police or ends up in an accident. And honestly, I don't know which one is worse. Lastly, you realize that Raymond may have poured you a bit too much, even though you had completely reached your capacity. And that explains why you got super drunk. Congratulations, you just memorized Guilford's idea of statistics. Guilford explained that statistics demands you to be in your exact description, clear and focused in thinking, following the determined procedure, derive a meaningful conclusion, make generalizations and predictions, and also find the causal factors of the phenomena or any other unexpected event. If you remember the story, you will remember the ideas. The best part about mathematics is that it remains fairly consistent across all fields. Thus, a geography student can understand the statistical procedures used in a psychological research, thus enhancing collaborative opportunities between the two fields. Of course, you need to know a few things before we get started. I'm sure all of you know basic mathematics. Don't worry, I'll still go over important concepts when we need them. And the symbols of various statistical variables will be talked about as they come up. So for now, let's just forget point 1 and point 5 and focus on the rest. Starting with variables, we know that even the name suggests it's something that varies. Variable can change with respect to time, subject to subject, distance, etc. But for now, let's just say variables are something which differ in magnitude and in some other dimensions. For example, your weight and my weight differs in intensity, as in you may be heavier, lighter, or approximately the same weight as I am. On top of that, your weight defines a quality other than your height. Your weight describes your heaviness, whereas your height describes your length. So maybe your weight and your height both are 165, but 165 pounds determines your heaviness, whereas 165 centimeters is how tall you are. Moving on to the idea of continuous variable. These variables, for example, height and weight, do not have discrete units. These are infinitely small gaps which are present between the scores. For example, your weight may appear 165 pounds, 165.5 pounds, or 165.54 pounds, depending upon the precision of the weighing machine. the values just melt into each other because there are no real gaps. Check out the diagram though. In a continuous series, the lower limit and the upper limit of a score can be found by subtracting and adding 0.5 respectively to the score. For example, the lower limit of the score 46 is 45.5. Similarly, the upper limit will be 46 plus 0.5, which is equal to 46.5. This is the easier version. A discontinuous variable is where the value has to be a whole number and there are gaps between values. For example, the number of peas you eat in breakfast or the number of books you buy for your classes. You never buy 2.567 books, you either buy 2 or 3. I know this sounds easy, which is why I have bad news for you. Rarely in the field of psychology do we have data sets which are discontinuous and have discrete values. Sorry. So what's a scale of measurement? Well, as the name suggests, it's basically different ways you can measure something. They are the second prerequisites of statistical psychology. Let's start with them one by one, and I promise you, you will get all of them if you just think simply. So the nominal scale is used to differentiate between people. Let's just say your house in school was the blue house. Your entire class is divided into four houses like every other class. Now your own class is 10 kids from the blue house and everyone is designated with a number. You have the number 7. So if anyone says, I want the 7th number of blue house, they'll be mentioning you. Thus, it is a simple way of assigning a code to a group or an individual. Two different symbols or numbers cannot be attached to the same thing. Imagine being number 7 of blue house and number 6 of yellow house. Well, that will mess up the entire configuration. Similarly, no two individuals or groups should have the same symbol or number. Like imagine having two blue houses in your class. Or maybe imagine having another number 7 of blue house in your class. I know, man, identity theft sucks. The limitation of nominal scale is that it tells us nothing about the type of student you are. It does not describe the qualities of the groups or individuals which it differentiates between. Next, we have the ordinal scale, where people are actually divided on the basis of merit within their own group. Let's think about the blue house. You're rank 1 and your friend Raymond is rank 2. It tells us that in academics, you're better than Raymond. The drawback here is that it does not tell us the difference in marks between you and Raymond. Maybe you are ahead of Raymond by a single mark. What about rank 3? What if Raymond is ahead of rank 3 by 50 marks? But poor Raymond still remains rank 2nd. Whereas his feat is almost equally amazing as yours. Hence the drawback of ordinal scale is that it may talk of merit, but it does not talk about the margin by which one stays ahead of someone else. The margin differs between each rank. Interval scale basically solves the problem of ordinal scale by fixing the margin between each score. Each score is differentiated by equal amount of difference. Notice the Celsius and Fahrenheit scale, which can easily drop below zero. That's because they have no true zero. Their zeros have been arbitrarily fixed and are meant to simply show relation between different scores. Notice how you hear about people scoring a 0 in NEET or JEE or MCAT or SAT. It does not mean that they have zero intelligence. It just means that on a standardized scale meant to size people against one another, they have scored a 0. It may very well be that the topper has only scored 5 marks while they have scored a 0. Ratio scale eliminates the problems of interval scale and introduces a 2-0. A 0 here would mean a complete absence of the entity, like Kelvin scale of temperature. A 0 would mean complete lack of heat. A 0 in terms of length and weight are all imaginable. This is a simpler case because principles of arithmetic work easily here. Something which is 10 inches long is twice the size of something 5 inches long, and something that is 300 Kelvin is half as hot as something which is 600 Kelvin. Sad to say, just like discontinuous variables, this is pretty rare in social sciences, which psychology is a part of. The last prerequisite for statistics we are going to talk about is rounding up. Without getting too much technical about error and all, let's just say that the answer of analysis generally has one more digit than the raw scores. For example, something like the mean of 2.3 and 4.6 and 4.3 will be 3.73. Moving on, I'm sure you all know how the rounding up works. If you have to round up, say 0.756, then we look at the last digit, which is greater than 5, it's a 6. Hence, the number becomes 0.6. Had it been less than 5, it would have stayed 0.75. In case of 5, remember that if the preceding number is odd, something must add up. That's just a small trick I use to remember that if it is 0.755, then it becomes 0.76, but if it is 0.725, then it becomes 0.72. Thank you for watching this video, and I'm happy if you stayed till the end. I'm so sorry for the torture. I know this is going to be a bumpy ride, but hang on, we'll pull through. Leave a like, comment, and subscribe if you want more of the videos, and let me know what should I be working on next. Thanks. Goodbye.